My name is William Pinkney. People call me Bill. My mother hated that. She said I named him William. Mothers are like that. And so I'm from Chicago. I'm a third generation Chicagoan. My grandfather, my father, and myself were all born in Chicago. That's why I live in Puerto Rico. One winter in Chicago will make you understand why being down there is so much better. I didn't sail as a child. I didn't start sailing till I was in the Navy, actually, but the Navy doesn't have, I'm not in the Navy that had sailing ships. I was in the other Navy. I did start sailing. After I got discharged from the Navy, I moved to Puerto Rico. That was my last duty station. And down there at the time, this was in the late 50s, they had bumboats, which were native schooners, which would take produce, equipment, washing machines, refrigerators, to the smaller islands because they didn't have any major transportation in there. And I was living down there as, let's say, a free soul. I don't want to say bum because that doesn't sound right. But I wanted to see the other islands. So what I would do is I would help them load these boats and sail from Puerto Rico, from San Juan, to Culebra, to Vieques, to St. Thomas. So that's how I started sailing. And down there, those guys were real sailors because the boats of wood, they were sailboats. Probably the biggest area of sail, or single area, was about that big. The patches, the whole thing. But these guys were great sailors. They had three lanterns. They had a red lantern, a green lantern, and white lantern in the back, and that was it. And a compass. And we leave at night. Next morning, we'd be right up on the islands because they're not very far away. The furthest distance was about 40 miles, and the boats were very slow. After I left there, I left, came back to the States, and I joined OPBC, which is the other people's boat club. It's the best one to belong to. You don't have any things to worry about. And I started sailing on the Great Lakes. And being from Chicago, that was the natural place for me to do it. And I sailed for a number of years. I sailed a Swan 44, which belonged to a gentleman there. And I raced the Chicago to Mackinac race, which is the longest freshwater race in the world. It's 333 miles from one end of Lake Michigan to the other. It can be dead calm, or it can be probably one of the most dangerous bodies of waters around. If you ever heard the story of the Edmund Fitzgerald, Lake Michigan sank it. So it's like that. And I decided at age 50 that I had lived better than half of my life. And if I was going to do anything adventurous, I better get going on it. And I wanted to leave a legacy for my grandchildren because they were getting no money. I was going to spend all I got of that. And I wanted to leave a benchmark for them, to show them what you could do with the basic things you learn in the first 12 years of school that in this country you get for free. Math, science, geography, history, all of those things. And I decided that since I love sailing more than anything else, I was going to sail. I was going to take my, that time, 32-foot boat, sail through the Panama and Suez canals, and write to my grandchildren. That was the idea I had. I made a mistake. I went to my elementary school reunion, and you know how school reunions are. Everyone tells a great story of what they're doing. They've developed a new way to make plastic. They've become the greatest heart surgeon in the world. They made $1 million in the stock market, all this stuff. And someone asked me what I was going to do. What I did, I said, well, I'm getting ready to sail around the world. Immediately, the principal of the school grabbed me, took me aside and said, you've got to come and talk to the kids in the fifth grade. They're the ones that need to hear what happens to kids when they get out of the school. They never see what happens. They just see them disappear and they don't know what happens. I said, fine, I'll come and talk to them. So I came and I talked to a fifth grade class, told them what I was going to do. And they said, would you write to us too? I said, fine, I'll write to you. Well, about a week later, I get a call from the Board of Education. And I figured, what's this about? Maybe I need permission, you know, to get parents to sign for these kids to be a part of this. said, this is Dr. Marge Harrigan. I'm the director of curriculum for Chicago Public Schools. And I'd like to talk to you about what you're going to do with Douglas School, my school. I go down and I explained it, everything I was going to do. And she said, marvelous. When you get a budget, I said, wait a minute, do what? She said, when you get a budget, you can develop. I said, wait a minute, lady. I got my boat paid for. I'm going to sail through the Panama Canal and I'm going to write these. No, you can't do that. You have to take this school area wide. I'm saying, oh boy. At this point, my little adventure for my grandkids, for one group of fifth graders in Chicago Public Schools, ended up being a 47-foot boat, not 32. It ended up being going around the earth under the five great capes, not through the Panama and Suez Canal. And it also ended up with not four, five kids, six or seven kids. I ended up with 30,000 kids. We ended up, I got in touch with friends of mine in the educational area. They developed a curriculum program. We put it all together. And I found the greatest thing of all, I found sponsorship. Because it was something I couldn't afford to do, but I did find sponsorship. And that took me around the world under the five great capes and stopping five times, 22 months. And I started in August and I ended up in June. Started in Boston to Bermuda, Bermuda to Brazil to Cape Town, South Africa, Hobart, Tasmania, around Cape Horn, Punta del Este, Uruguay, back up to Brazil, Bermuda, and back to Boston. And when I got back, I wrote a children's book for first graders from McGraw-Hill. And that was a part of their Basel reading program for first graders to learn how to read. And then I went on a speaking circuit and I had a great time doing that. Later, I wrote an autobiography and it did okay till the publisher went bankrupt. And so it's out there somewhere. But I thought in the last couple of years that I wanted to write a book for kids that were older, because now all the children that read my first grade book were now having children of their own. Because in June of this past year, I celebrated 30 years since I got back. So I started writing again and I took all the little things and put them together. I joined with a young woman who I've been knowing for years, maybe 40 years. She and I belong to a ski club in Chicago. We skied a lot. She is a commercial artist and she also is a sailor. One of the group of women sailors at Jackson Park Yacht Club in Chicago that has probably more women boat owners and skippers than any place I've ever been. And they have a youth program now that brings inner city kids over to Jackson Park and allows them to learn to sail on, I think they use Dyer dinghies, and I think they may have a couple of 420s. So that program is involved in them. As I came back, I also got the opportunity to become a part of Mystic Seaport Museum. I was a member of the Board of Trustees there for 14 years. During that time, we established, raised the money, and built the Freedom Schooner Amistad, which was able to sail all around the United States. We went to 51 cities, as far west as Chicago, and as far north as Halifax, Nova Scotia. Then we went down to Key West, Florida, and into New Orleans. And in 2007, we took the boat to England, and then down to Portugal, and to Sierra Leone, the home of the African captives. If you don't know the story, or might not have seen the Spielberg movie, you can look it up. It's a very, very interesting story about what became the first human rights case in the United States Supreme Court. And then I retired for a little while. In 2010, they called me back again, and I was able to sail the boat into Havana, Cuba, the first American flagship to sail into Havana, Cuba, under the American flag, the Cuban flag, and the flag of the United Nations to celebrate International Slavery Remembrance Day. So what we're here today is talking is to kind of give you an idea of the book that I wrote, with the idea of it being in mind for young adults and for old young adults, because what I wanted to do was to write the book to tell the story and to kind of illustrate it so that young people particularly will see what it's like to have an adventure and to hopefully have an adventure of their own. And when I say an adventure, I don't mean to sail around the world. I mean, an adventure can be working toward a goal of a career. It can be working toward the goal of being a parent, to have a family. All of those things are goals. And the idea and the name of the boat was commitment, because that's what I felt and that's what I named the boat. Believing that a commitment is a promise you make to yourself that you're going to accomplish something and never quit. And that's what I tried to do with the Around the World voyage. So right now, I'll read you a little bit about it. This all started with the seventh grade. And the seventh grade is when I got the inspiration to do this, but it took me till I was 55 to do it. I'm a slow learner. You got me. Well, it starts out very simply, just trying to get an idea. It says school was difficult for me, but in the seventh grade, something wonderful happened. I started to love to read. It was that love for reading that changed my whole life and set me on the path to my great adventure. In the seventh grade, I read a book by an author named Armstrong Sperry. And this book is still in print today, written in 1940. And it won the 1940 Newbery Book Award for Children. And it's still in schools today and it's still available in, I think, on Amazon or any of those places you might find a book. It was called, the name of it was called It Courage. It was a story that touched my heart because I felt very much like the hero of this book. He, like me, had been an outcast. He had become afraid of the water and me because in school, I was one of the few Black children and the other kids were not kind to me. I grew up without a father. My parents were divorced when I was six. So my mom, my sister, and I were on public aid for a while. Always on the outside, I never was being a part of the crowd. I felt alone. When I read this story about this young boy who was on the outside like me and how he took his destiny in his own hands and had a great adventure, I knew that's what I wanted to do. The story is about a boy named Mufatu. He lived on a Polynesian island in the South Pacific where the weather was always beautiful and the seas were wide and inviting. His story started when he was a baby in his mother's arms. One day while she was out fishing near the reefs, just off their island, a storm came up suddenly and the little outrigger canoe was turned over by a huge wave and she tried with all her might to swim for shore, holding her son in her arms, but the sea was too strong and she drowned. He somehow survived and from that day forward, he was afraid of the sea. When you live on an island, everything you do has to do with water, getting food by fishing, playing with your friends, by swimming and paddling your canoe in races, even traveling from one place to the other, all done on the water. So being afraid of the water would separate you from everything that everyone else would do. So Mufatu was forced to do the cooking and cleaning chores around his family household, because he would not go out and do the things that other boys his age would do. Finally, one day, when he could no longer stand the jokes and the bullying from the other boys, he called on all of his courage and strength, took a canoe, food, and his dog, and set out to sea for an island he could see off in the far distant horizon. He felt that his fear was easier to deal with than the pain of being an outcast. After a couple of days of sailing in the direction he'd seen the other canoes sail, he found an island. It appeared to be uninhabited. And when he got to shore, he explored the little island and found that he was alone. There were, however, many statues and altars. He had many adventures in his new home, like hunting for a wild boar for food and ultimately taking the boar's teeth for a necklace. He built himself a shelter, and during his exploration, discovered that there were people who came to the island to make human sacrifices. One night they arrived and chased him. He escaped to sea and sailed away to return to his home. When he returned, no one recognized him at first because he had been gone for a while and he had grown taller, stronger, and wore a boar's tooth necklace, which only the great warriors wore. He came home a hero. Reading that, oh, how I wanted to have a great adventure too. In my mind, as I grew up, was the idea of someday I would be like Mafatu, and I too would have a great adventure. The rest I'll leave up to you. And that great adventure became very interesting for me because I was able to sail to, again, as I said before, Bermuda. I had a lot of friends there who had lived in New York and had moved back home. So I enjoyed that a great deal, having a meeting with them again. I sailed to Brazil. Brazil was very interesting for me because for a person of African descent, it's very interesting. It's the closest place I could get to African tradition without being in Africa itself. Beautiful place, Bahia, great beaches, great food, great music, wonderful place, enjoyed it. The place that I dreaded was Cape Town, South Africa. I had to stop there because from there I'd be crossing the Indian Ocean and that was going to be a 50 or 55 day trip. So I needed to get provisions, water, and et cetera. So my idea was to do this, get water, get food, and get the hell out of South Africa as fast as I could. Because I'm 87 years old and I grew up in a time when in my Navy uniform, in many places in the United States, I would not be served. So I knew what apartheid, which was their version of segregation, was like and did not want to experience that again. I found out a lot of things there. I was met in Table Bay, as you come into Cape Town, by a young man who I'd met earlier, who was from South Africa, who was in the United States. I was trying to raise money to do the Around the World race. He brought me in to the Royal Cape Yacht Club. And I sat there and I had my papers and was checking in through customs. And the customs people came. Very stern-faced guys, Afrikaners, with the uniforms gray and their peak hats. And they looked like they were, to me, looked like the Gestapo. And I was saying, oh boy, this is not going to be a good thing. Someone had made for me a stamp. And he said, look, when you go overseas, they're going to stamp everything you got. You get a stamp, and when they stamp it, you stamp it. He says, the bureaucrats love it. I said, okay. So I did that. So these guys came in, opened their books, laid the papers out. I brought my papers out. They'd write down. They'd ask me questions about the boat. They'd write that down. Boom, they'd stamp it, hand me a paper over there, and boom, I'd stamp it too. And I did all that. Finally, we got through with all of this thing. And these guys were stone-faced through the whole thing, and I'm not saying a word. The guy got finished me, and he looks across the table at me for a minute, turns around and says, where? Beer's all around. How did you like the trip over? What did you see? How was it going? Did your boat hold up? Totally different. And I learned a lesson then. And as I went through Cape Town, Nelson Mandela had been released a week before I got there. And I met all sorts of people. And I found out this lesson. Governments make laws. Politicians make policy. But people make nations. And when you meet people one by one by one, you find the same. They want the same thing you do. They want longevity, good health. They want peace in their family, in their nation, in the world. They want to see their children grow up to have a better life than they've had. It's universal. Every place I went, I found that. And I found that was my first lesson on my trip around the world. I learned a lot of other lessons as well. I learned you're smarter than you think you are. You really are. You know, everything that you see, touch, smell, feel, hear, it all goes into that brain. It's there. It's always there. Getting it back out, of course, is not always easy, particularly when you need it. So you're smarter. There were many times I would have a problem and I would solve it and say, gee, where did I learn to do that? Smarter. You're also dumber than you think you are. Because anybody that tells you they know all about sailing, do not get on a boat with them. It's a lifetime learning process. Every time you go to sea, you learn something. You learn about your boat. You learn about the sea. You learn about weather. You learn about so many things. But the big thing you learn about is yourself. You learn that your limitations are not what you think your limitations are. Because you're forced by circumstances at sea. Whether you're sailing out here on this little area here, or you're sailing in the middle of the Atlantic or Pacific Oceans, your limit and your limitations stop here. You say, I reached my limit, I can't go any further. But if you move, your limit moves with you. And if you keep going, you'll never reach that limit. So many of us don't succeed in the things we want to because we allow that limit to be as far as we go, because we stop. As long as you're moving ahead, that limit is always ahead of you. Once you stop, that's it. I learned that very quickly. And it was one of the things I learned. And again, about people, one of the things about people I learned is that all of us in this room and everyone that I met has been acted upon by a great conspiracy. And the people that put this conspiracy onto us is a group of people called mothers. Now, I'm not going to ask any of the women in here to divulge anything, but I know for a fact, universally, there is a mother's school somewhere. Everybody's mother went to that school. Every place I went, I've told this story and they all agreed. Mothers are all physicians. They can look across the room and say, you're not looking too well, come here. Put their hand on her forehead and tell within 2 degrees when you have a fever and know what to do to make you feel better. Mothers also have x-ray vision. They can see through walls, jungles, sand dunes, anything, and see when you're doing the wrong thing on the other side. Mothers, unlike Einstein, who believe this, mothers don't believe this. Mothers can bend light and see around corners and catch you at those things you don't want to be caught at. But the biggest thing about mothers, and the biggest thing I found about this conspiracy, is this. No matter who you get to be, no matter what your title is, no matter what accolades you get, your mother, no matter how old you get to be, is the one person that can look in your eyes and tell when you're lying. If we were able to take all the politicians, all the financiers on Wall Street who've been dealing under the table, all of those guys that say that they're out saying, give me $1 million and I'll make you rich. Take them all, line them up against the wall and say, tell your mother what you told me. We find that lie detectors would go out of business. So the universal thing that brings us all together is that we are all more alike than not alike. And I think that was one of the things that this story has taught me. So if you have any questions about anything, I'll try to answer them. I'll have an answer for everyone. May not be a right answer, but I'll have an answer for everyone. Anyone have any questions about sailing, about life in Chicago? Yes, ma'am.
Elementary school, they're online with us.
Okay.
And they to know, is there one thing that stands out the most about what the sea has to teach people about the world?
One thing.
Well, there are, couple of
oh, there's a lot. There are a lot of things. The sea will teach you that you don't control everything you think you can. It does what it wants to do. You're at its mercy. You need to be prepared for anything. It also teaches you about fear. People tell me, were you ever afraid out there? And I say, absolutely not. I was never afraid. And here's the reason. To me, fear is when you don't know something. If you go into a room and it's dark, you're going to be afraid. You've never been there before. You don't know what's in there. You turn on the light, you see what's there, nothing. That enlightenment removes your fear. When I went to sea, I knew what was going to happen out there. I knew that if I didn't do things right, I was not coming home. So I wasn't afraid of it, but I was aware. I paid attention and I did the lessons to learn what I needed to do to be successful at what I wanted. And I think that's what we all have to understand. Don't be afraid of it, learn about it. And I think the kids should know that. If you're afraid of something, learn more about it. And you'll find out more times than not. Nothing to be afraid of, it's just something you don't know. Yes, ma'am.
I apologize, I came in a little bit late. What was the boat that you sailed
around? I sailed around a boat around the world in a Valiant 47. It was a larger version of a boat called a Valiant 40. That probably has sailed more, cruised more times around the world than any other boat. This was a 47-foot version of it. It was built on the cruising boat hull, but it was designed specifically to sail around the world in the 1986 Around the World Race. So it was designed completely for single-handed sailing. So everything I needed was on it. It had double everything. Double halyards, double sheets. I had 15 winches, which I couldn't all control at all at the same time. None of them were electric, but I had to do it by hand. It had watertight bulkheads, which made it easier for me to deal with heavy wind instead of having to reef the sail the first time. I just filled up my water ballast tank on the windward side, and that would bring the boat back to level again. I had, if you're out in the museum, you'll see a little thing about this big with little pieces on it. It looks like a solar panel and a white dome on it. That was my contact with the students. It was a device that sent a signal from the boat to a satellite that gave my latitude, longitude, barometric pressure, and air temperature. So the kids around the country in Chicago would either call in Chicago or into the Boston Computer Museum and be able to track me 6 times a day on my entire trip for 22 months. So the boat itself was made exactly for what I was able to use it for. I had an electronic autopilot to steer the boat, but the one I used was a wind vane, which the wind, when I adjusted the panel on it so that the wind came on both sides of it, it would stay like this and keep the rudder. But if the wind turned it at all, it would lean like this, pull the plunger up, turn a gear, and the rudder would steer it till it came back up like this. I steered with that 85% of the time. So I wasn't constantly on the wheel, which was good. Oddly enough, something happened to me. I was in the Indian Ocean. I was cruising along pretty good, maybe 8 or 9 knots, having a good time. I had one reef in the main, my head sailed up, no staysail. The wind went from 25 knots to 50 knots, just like that. What they call the microburst. The boat went from here to there. Boat laid down. The minute the wind ceased, of course, nothing would hold the boat down. So the boat started to right itself. The minute the wind vane caught the wind again, that swung the boat right back on course. It did that 2 times. The other time it happened, I came over you have swells in the ocean. Sometimes the swells can be 18, 20 feet high. Now, that's not a wave, that's a swell. It's like a long valley. Sometimes I get to the top of it and I could see it, the valley, at least a mile long. Came, I was cruising right up the top of the valley. A rogue wave came right down the top, hit the boat, knocked it down into the trough, swung it back up, wind vane brought it back up. So it was built to do that.
Wow.
Yeah.
What did you find your wake sleep cycle was?
I was just telling a young lady when we came up here that brought me up from Mystic. I don't sleep. I can never, if the best sleep I can ever get is if I can sleep 6 hours. Generally, I sleep in 2 hour chunks now, even after that time. I'll sleep for a couple of hours, I'll wake up for a little while, and I'll do whatever I need, try to do, go back to sleep. I do that because when I was out there, I slept when I was tired. I ate when I was hungry. We generally eat at breakfast time, lunch time, and dinner time. There were no breakfast, lunch, or dinner time. There was no, I'll wait till the late news goes off and I'll go to bed. No, you slept when you could get sleep, and you ate when you were hungry. So my circadian rhythm just went out of the box. So that's the same now. My wife bugs me to death. It's lunchtime to eat. I said, I'm not hungry. But you got to eat. No, I don't have to eat. It'll take me a month to die of starvation. I will eat before then. But it's hard. It's hard to get people to understand that because we are regimented all our lives to eat breakfast, lunch, dinner at those times of the day. So your whole cycle gets changed and you sleep. Now that I'm older, I get those 2 hour sleeps, not at night, usually in front of the TV in the afternoon. but I don't have a what I could call a regular sleep pattern. I don't know if it helps. It affects other solo sailors the same way. But generally, that's generally what we do. And we sometimes we could be awake. When I was in the shipping lanes, when I was crossing shipping lanes, sometimes I would go, 18, 20, 24 hours without sleeping at all. Because one of my biggest fears was not weather. My biggest fears were those big steel things that were moving at three times the speed I was. And you're like a speck out there. And they can run you over. It's 2.5 miles from the horizon in front of you to where you are if you're 6 feet off the water. So that's 2.5 that way, 2.5 that way, that's 5 miles. They can cover 5 miles in 20, 30 minutes. So if you're down below and you take a nod, they can run over you, you're gone and be gone, and you never know it. I had one incident where that happened. Not completely. I came up and I looked up, and as far as from here to that wall over there, I saw the trail in of a Taiwanese fishing boat. I don't know if he saw me in turn or was the luck of the draw. And it just, that was that close. That's the only close call I had with a ship. And that was enough to make me stay awake a lot. Yeah. Yeah. Anybody else? Other questions?
Where's your boat now?
I don't know. I'm trying to find it. I was just down at Mystic Sea, at Mystic Seaport. When I was sponsored by four guys in Boston, and at the end of the sponsorship, they got the boat since they paid for it, and they sold it to a man named King in Fort Lauderdale, and he had the boat up until about 2 years ago. And as I would go into Fort Lauderdale with other boats and other things, I would see it back up in one of the canals there. For what I understand, he never really sailed it. He had three other boats. I think he bought it because it was around the boat, world boat. And 2 years ago, I heard that it was up for sale and it was not in good shape because it had been sitting in the dock so long and it was sold. Mystic Seaport has asked me to find it because they're very interested in it. And so when I get back, I'll start the search to find out where it is. I would have loved to have had that boat when I came back. It was best friend I ever had. And it was a great boat. It it took me through a lot of things, and it was it rode smooth as a Cadillac. And that's what it is. So I don't have it now. I've had one other boat since then. I had a 40-foot catamaran, which is hull number one of the Voyage catamaran series. And we had that with a partner in Puerto Rico, and we did day sail, 7-day charters, term charters to the British Virgin Islands. And we had a very good business from 2017 until COVID hit. COVID hit and the tourists dried up. And to keep a boat in a marina down there, you know, it was like $1,200 a month. And if you're not making, if you're not bringing in that revenue, that'll soon eat up your savings and everything else. So we sold the boat. And when the boat was being transferred by the new owner from one spot to another, it ran on a sandbar. They tried to pull it off. The keels, one of the keelsons snapped, and she flooded, and it became a salvage boat after that. So I'm boatless. Say what? Oh, yes. Yes. Other people boats. I have a guy that's coming down in November. Yeah, November. And he's never been in the Caribbean before, and he wants me to help show him around. Yes. Yes. I mean, you have to do it. Yes, sir. We were blessed. Maria took the roof off my house.
Where do you live in Puerto Rico?
I live in the northeast corner in Fajardo. Yeah. And that showed us that we would not live in a house on the second floor again with a corrugated roof. We bought a house which is all concrete. But this last one, we were so fortunate. It went south of us. So we only got winds up to about 45 miles an hour and rain for about 4 days. On the southern portion where it went onto the south, they got wiped out. Ponce, Salinas, from the center, which is Ponce to Salinas, all the way out there, they were absolutely flooded. There are pictures of that where the houses right from the water front all the way back in. And unlike it is up in Florida where that happened, where people build right on the beach, these people were back off the beach, and the surge just went right straight back. And they're still suffering from that now, trying to build back. Up in my area, we've pretty much recovered completely from Maria.
Bill, a number of people here in the room are doing North American rallies for me. So I just want to let you know, how many of you are doing that?
The North American what?
The North American rally for you.
You're coming down. All right. You're going from where? You're coming from up here? I say, Mark. Yeah, you know what? I got, for years, I badmouthed multi-hull sailors. I mean, I badmouthed them. Because all my 14 mechs, I did those on a 44-foot Swan. So, you know, that was a monohull, man. And I got my first multi-hull ride on a F-40, one of these little boats, and I fell in love with it. But I didn't get one of those. And I didn't want to go around the world in that. But a guy from Michigan had a boat called Lucky Strike, a trimaran, and he was in that rally. And a guy got sick on the boat, and he pulled into Puerto Rico. And I saw the boat because I knew the name from the Chicago to Mac race. And I met him, and he was saying that he had to drop out of the race, but he also wanted to take his boat to St. Lucia, that's where they were going to go. And so he went back to the States, came back about 3 months later, and asked me would I help him and his buddy who was coming down, sail the trimaran down to St. Lucia. I'm hot to trot now. I'm going to get one of those fast boats. We're going to boogie big time. The wind was right on the nose. I think the best we got out of that boat was about 8 knots. Now, this is a boat that can do 20. Best, right on the nose, right on, all the way to St. Lucia from Puerto Rico. So I hope you guys have better wind coming down than we had going. So if you happen to fall by the wayside around Puerto Rico, give me a call. I'll give you my card. I'll give you my card, and if you happen to pull in there and you need something, I can fix you with anything you need. We got everything down there.
Huh? I'll give you a boat ride.
Okay, I'll take it. I'll take a ride. Do you know all about sailing?
No.
Okay, I'll sail with you. We'll learn together. That's the first question I say. You know all about sailing? Yeah. Thank you very much. We gave you the office. We ain't going to give again.
Somebody says they're both perfect, I walk away.
That's it. Yeah, none's perfect.
So, Bill, the students have another question for you. People in general seem disconnected from nature. I wondered if Captain Pinkney has any thoughts about that.
Yeah. I have a lot of thoughts about that. We are net. We're all connected by nature, be it in the sea or the land. We exist in nature. Everything that we survive on is nature. And we sometimes forget it. And we also forget that America, the United States of America, is a maritime nation. We forget that. The clothes we wear, the sneakers we wear, everything. The cars we drive, it all comes by sea. And we forget that. And we have to remember that.
Tell the children to put these away.
Yeah.
Put these away.
The most frustrating things I see is to see a group of young people, and adults as well, sitting in a group, supposedly all going to be together with their friends, and all of them are doing this, not talking to each other at all. Text each other. People, when I assign books and everything, people say, "Oh, you have such lovely handwriting." I said, "Yeah, cursive. They taught me to do that in school. They taught me to write. They didn't teach me to type. I can't type. And that's great for me with a computer because I go slow on that. I have to write. I write letters with a pen, you know, and send it through the mail, the snail mail they call it, because it's a way of communication." I think we're losing a lot of communication skills because of that, because we've gotten so technical. A thing that I didn't experience until maybe 3 months ago, I knew the end was coming. My second wife was a restaurateur in Chicago. She was very famous there. She writes a column for the newspaper. She does television there. And one of the things in her restaurant, she had a breakfast restaurant. She treated breakfast like it was dinner, white tablecloth, everything. When you came in the restaurant, you had to turn off your phone. You were not allowed to use a cell phone in a restaurant. When she first did that, she was one of the first restaurants in Chicago to do that. People were irate. I'm sorry. What happened is people who really wanted to have breakfast and talk to their loved ones and friends started flocking. Wonderful, and more restaurants started doing that. It's it's so important that you have that kind of a communication. But I lost my train of thought. I do that a lot. We were talking about
children.
Yeah, and getting young people to talk to each other and to write, and to communicate, because that's the best way we can understand each other, and to listen, have other people not tell us what to know, to find out for ourselves. And I've been watching. Oh, the thing I was going to tell you about was I went to a restaurant, and I go and I sit down at a table. I love to eat, right? I go to a restaurant and I'm sitting there, and I'm waiting for the waiter to come and give me the menu and everything. The waiter comes over and says, "Oh, you're right on the table. You just put your cell phone over there." And I said, "What?" He says, "Oh, yeah." I said, "Uh-uh. I want a menu in my hand. I want to see it. And when you come back, I want you to explain to me what the good things are and what you had here to eat. I don't want to put it over there on the electronic." We're getting so attached. Go into the go into Walmart, do my shopping, come. No, I got to go. I got to bag my own things. I got to do it on this computer thing. And I still got to pay them. No way. You know, we're taking people out of those things. And we wonder why there's so much unemployment. Well, because we're pushing people out of it, out of employment. I went to a fast food restaurant, Mystic Seaport. I love the Seaport. I was a trustee there for 14 years. I hadn't been there in 6 years. I'm used to going into the galley there and saying, I want this, that, and the other. I go in and they got this big board and you got to type what you want into the thing about, duh. Yeah. We got a lot to learn. We need to go back to nature. We need to learn to write. We need to learn to read. And we need to understand that all the pollution, all the things that we're suffering from today are because we have forgotten how to live like human beings and not to be automatrons. And it's sad. I'm not a troglodyte. I'm not against electronics and all those things. I enjoy it. I mean, I'm on the web as much as anybody, but I mean, there's a limit to that. If it becomes what controls your life, I think it's not a quality of life I'd like to be part of. Anybody else have a question about anything?
Bill, speaking of goals, do you have any upcoming goals that you'd like to share with us?
About sailing or in general?
General?
I have some I can't talk about, but that's all right.
In general.
Oh, you know, at this point in life, I find that I'm not quite as agile to sail on a lot of boats as I would like to. My goals are not to sail on any boats under 60 feet. The decks are wide. You know, that's hard to walk on a deck that small. Anyway, I'm a big fan of Formula One racing, and my one of my big goals is to go to Monaco for the Formula One race. That's one of the big things I want to do. I still have one thing that I'd like to do, and that's I'd like to do a transatlantic solo from west to east, probably from somewhere up here to England or come around down to Portugal. About 60 feet. About 60, 65, yeah. And I probably won't do it with a crew to do it, but I just would just like to go across that way. And the other thing is to go back to all the places that I sailed on my round the world trip, to go back to Bermuda, to go back to Salvador de Bahia in Brazil, Punta del Este, Uruguay. If you ever get a chance to go there, it's heaven. It's the Riviera of South America. It's where all the rich Brazilians and Argentinians go to hang out during this season. We're having winter. They're just now starting to open their season down there. It's the first place I've ever been where when you go into places and see people buying stuff, they treat $100 bills like we treat 20s. I mean, it's gobs of money, but some of the greatest beaches and some great sailing down there that I'd like to do. And I'd like to go back to Cape Town, South Africa, because the families that adopted me over there, I'm on the internet with them and email even to this day, 30 years later. I just got one of the young men, I just got a thing today that he just got an award and they sent me, you know, Dion has just got an award for whatever. So that I'd like to do again. And I'd like to be 20 years younger. Hey, you asked me, so I tell you. Anybody else have any questions? Well, I hope you guys that are going to do the sail down to the wonderful part of the world have a good sail down there. A lot of times when I write people, I'll write fair winds, smooth seas, and good shipmates to share it with. That helps a lot. There are people that I would invite to my house, I would never invite on my boat.
Thank you so much, Bill. I know.